Mr. Piyush Goyal, the Honorable Minister of State with Independent Charge for Power, Coal, New and Renewable Energy, a chartered accountant and a lawyer by education. He has served on board of State Bank of India and Bank of Baroda. He has also advised top corporate on management strategies and growth. Mentored by political and intellectual stalwart Sri Atal Bihari Vajpayee, Mr. Piyush Goyal has held several important positions in BJP. He was nominated by Government of India to the prestigious task for interlinking of rivers in 2002. A strong advocate of empowerment over entitlement, his vision is to provide energy access at affordable prices to every citizen of this country. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Mr. Piyush Goyal to inspire us by his worthy words.
Thank you very much for the warm welcome. But this really looks like a film set, you know. And I didn't know I'll have to walk down the ramp also before I start. But thank you very much for this wonderful opportunity to be in one of the 20 cities selected to be a smart city. And under very tough conditions. It was a hugely difficult process, entailed a lot of competition, challenges, but I'm delighted that Indore made it, and I'm sure all the people of Indore must have had a huge role to play in that, and I compliment each and every one of you for this huge success. My elder brother, the most illustrious Deepak Parekhji, we both come from Mumbai, we are both we've both known each other many years, but for me it's really a privilege to be able to share the stage with him and get the opportunity to confer this most well-deserved award to Deepak Bhai, who to my mind is probably one of the finest management gurus India has ever produced. Not only has he run a very, very successful enterprise, or rather several enterprises, but I believe he has led from the front in terms of articulating good principles of management, which for years to come will continue to teach students, will continue to help all of us. Congratulations, Deepak Bhai, on this very, very prestigious award. Dr. Mashalkar has just joined us, somebody we all look up to as an icon. Sir, it's a privilege to get a chance to speak before you, sir. What you have done for the country, I think, will be etched in our history for years and years to come. And all of us will always be grateful for bringing that scientific temper into government working, into the nation. And the fact that you continue to engage with so many of our programs encourages us a lot. Thank you very much for all your support. Mr. Shiv Singh Mehta, Chairman IMA, Mr. N. Mohan, Director IMA, also the Conclave Chairman, Mr. Vijay Goyal, the President of the IMA, Mr. Santosh Muchal, Vice President of the IMA, Mr. Rohit Gadia, CEO Capital Via, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, and the young students who have come in here this morning. I was just getting to know a little bit more about IMA as I was reading that lovely audiovisual put together by the young boys and girls. And I suddenly realized you were established in 1963. And it only made me realize that probably I'm also getting older, but I'm a tad younger than you, born 1 year later after the IMA. But it's a great thing. The way the presentation was made, the IMA logo and the IMA confidence that was demonstrated in the AV, I thought could be supplemented with, I am an Indian. I am a proud citizen of this country. I am an outstanding manager. I am an agent of change. I am an element of the future of this country. And I think in that sense, the fact that IMA over the last 53 years has served industry, trade, business, management colleges, not only in central India, but has been an integral part of the management story in the country, is a matter of great pride for each one of us here. And I compliment IMA for the successes. Of course, this conclave itself is now turning 25 this year. And 25 years of getting some very illustrious names. We saw Amitabh Bachchan coming in here. We saw very, very senior business leaders like Rahul Bhai and Mr. Kumar Mangalam Birla. And in some sense, I feel a little out of place because there were not too many politicians there. But I do believe it will be an interesting opportunity to share some of the vision of this government with the distinguished gathering this morning. Of course, Mr. Shiv Mehta just spoke about the challenges and how the entire business scene, the economy is changing, not only in India, but globally. But I think that is the one lesson that Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi shared with all of us as soon as we took charge of the government, that the deep-rooted problems that we had inherited should not intimidate us in our work, but should be looked at as an opportunity to change, as an opportunity to convert this crisis and rewrite the story so that we can take India down a new path of development, create an enabling framework that the Indian economy can actually look forward to years and years of growth, years and years of good government, good governance. And in that sense, while the world is witnessing a series of problems, most developed countries are struggling to even maintain the nominal levels of growth that they have. Many parts of the world today are facing a series of problems, some of them related to their economy, many tensions around the world, particularly in the Middle East. Inter-regional disparities seem to have grown in the last 3 or 4 decades. And in a climate where, by and large, we are seeing doom and gloom all around, I think India is looking to be that one star which can lead the economic recovery of the world. And it's towards that end that when we in government were trying to build the narrative of our work, decide what we are going to do in this 5-year span that we have, we had two choices before us. We had the choice of some very good quick wins, some band-aid solutions to the problems before the nation. Look at how we could make the people feel happy very quickly, and maybe plan for the election after election. You're all aware that India has an election every 3 months or 6 months in some part of the country. And historically, we have always planned our economic policy, planned our work around elections when we are in government. Prime Minister Modi wanted to change that. And his focus was that we are not looking to build a small two-story, three-story building. We are not looking at a five-year plan when we are in government. We should lay the foundation for years and years and years and decades of good government, good governance, economic growth, prosperity for all. And in that sense, let's take this opportunity to plan like one would a skyscraper. Let's go deep down, do a deep dive, analyze what went wrong, what should have been done better, what can be corrected, dig deep, create a strong, solid foundation. A foundation which does not support only a small building, but a foundation which can support a very, very large superstructure. In some sense, reflecting that you may need to take a lot of pain in the initial period. You may need to really dig deep to get the muck out of the way. It may take you some time to build a robust foundation. But use the best of equipment, use the best of tools, don't compromise on quality, plan well so that what you do is efficient, do your work transparently and honestly so that you are leaving behind a structure which can truly support India in its growth story, support the future of India for years and years to come. And therefore, most of the work that this government has initiated and focused its efforts on have largely been in the nature of framework setting and strengthening institutions so that for years to come, India can be more safe, can be a secure economy, and the next generation can be left behind a better world, a better country to live in. I remember even when I first was working out my renewable energy programs, and somebody did mention I have power and renewable energy. Fortunately, he didn't bring coal in between, because in some sense, I am the polluter and I am the person who's responsible to try and clean the mess. But when we were planning our renewable energy program going forward, there were significant challenges that were brought to fore. There was the issue of pricing, with costs of renewable energy being more. There was the huge challenge of transmission ability, since you need a disproportionate transmission capacity to support renewable energy. There was the challenge of different time periods when you are able to generate renewable energy, therefore requiring large spinning reserves or peaking reserves, which obviously adds to the cost. When we looked at solar energy, there was the challenge of getting adequate land, even though it's wasteland and barren land. But Prime Minister was very clear that when we are planning the country's future, energy security and a clean environment are two principles on which this government will not compromise. And renewable energy brings energy security to our nation. Renewable energy helps us to leave a cleaner and better planet for the next generation. Because like Mahatma Gandhi had said, we are only trustees of the planet, of the universe, or of our country. All of us in this room largely are in their middle or later years of life. We can only be trustees of this nation, so that what we leave behind for the next generation should be a tad better than what we inherited. And in that sense, I think every management principle evolves around this basic structural framework that a good manager bothers more about process is worried more about systems, is focused more about the means rather than only the end, is interested in leaving behind legacies, and a legacy which people in the future can be proud of, should be looking to emulate, should be wanting to learn from. And in that sense, it's a delightful experience to see senior managers in industry engaging with young students so that we can share our own experiences, so that we can engage with them to get newer and fresher ideas in our own work. And this amalgamation of youthfulness and the enthusiasm that comes from youth and experience and the knowledge that comes from experience can together weave a good story. And be it a corporate, be it the government, be it an NGO, in some sense, the principles remain the same. They don't change whether you run an NGO, whether you run the government of India, a political party. I remember when I was looking after the advertising campaign of the general election of 2014, which brought Prime Minister Modi and all of us into government. We were planning a massive outreach campaign to reach out to the people. But very early on in the planning stage itself, I engaged Ernst & Young as an auditor to ensure the sanctity of the entire advertising process, not only in terms of the monetary expenditure that we spend, which is typically an auditor's job that all of us do, but also to see the efficacy of the spend, to see that we are getting a big bag for every buck that we spend, to ensure that what is the outcomes of the entire budget that we put into advertising. And I remember a lot of criticism was made, some comments were made against my party and me particularly. In fact, comments also made by leaders who come from your region of Indore, trying to allege that I'm sure most people would have figured out whom I'm alluding to. Trying to allege that my party spent 5,000 crore rupees or I don't know, such fancy numbers on that advertising campaign. Of course, now the information is all public. It's in public domain. The expense accounts are all duly audited and put on the website and with the election commission, with the tax authorities. But we had not spent even one-tenth of that amount. Not even one-tenth of that amount. But all of you will recall the campaign of 2014 Lok Sabha elections. It was a campaign which went to the length and breadth of the country and could touch 125 crore Indians. Of course, there's no doubt that if you don't have a good product, the best of campaigns can't sell. And any marketing person in the room will tell us that unless your perfume smells well, you can't sell that perfume. Unless a food product is tasty to the taste buds, it's not going to be accepted by the people. And similarly, unless you have a leader of the charisma, of the commitment, of the integrity, and proven track record that Prime Minister Modi was offering to the people of India, surely the people would not have given such an outstanding support to him. So we had a good leader, we had a good offering. But to make that reach to the people, we needed a process, we needed a durable campaign. And why I'm highlighting this example is that if during the course of the planning of the entire campaign, we had not taken the help of experts, we had not brought in certain principles which would guide us through the entire campaign, if we had not had proper auditing, if we had not been honest in our working, possibly we would have landed up spending what I was alleged to have spent. But good management principles brought into even a political party, good management principles brought into an NGO's working, can keep your admin costs low and ensure that every rupee that the people give out of philanthropy is well spent. And similarly, when we come to corporates, when we come to the economy, when we come to our businesses, unless we work through systems, unless we work through plans, we are not going to be able to get the kind of outcomes that are desirable, that are expected of us as good managers. Therefore, when we set around to repairing the economy, to bringing growth back on track, to trying to change the rules of government, to bring in some good governance into the working of the government, all of that, in some sense, reflected the reinventing growth subject that your conclave this time has. It involved reinventing so many processes. You're all aware of what I went through in the coal ministry. That was probably an area, and I don't know, by coincidence again, I've not planned it, it's not there anywhere, but the same gentleman from the city, in fact, in Parliament once very tauntingly told me that Goyal ji, koile mein bada, koile ki dalali mein haath kala hai, or something of that sort. Unfortunately, he didn't realize that wo kaam pehle hota tha. Things have changed now. I still remember 24th of September 2014 when the Honorable Supreme Court decided to cancel the allotment of 204 coal mines. If any of you recall those days, you had newspaper headlines screaming that country is going to run out of coal and all of us are going to be plunged in darkness. And you'll all recall that period where more than two-thirds of the plants, power plants in India, were starved of coal, which is a basic ingredient to producing power. And in that situation, when I was discussing with Prime Minister Modi and Finance Minister Mr. Arun Jaitley about the way forward, I assure you, the only one directive that they gave me was create a framework which will be long-lasting, which will be transparent and honest, and which will ensure that the natural resources of this country will serve the people of this country and cannot be given away for free to your friends or relatives or political party members. And it was on the fulcrum of this one piece of advice that we were able to reinvent the entire coal sector to a situation where not only did we have the most transparent and equal opportunity auction of coal mines, which ultimately over the next 25, 30 years will give lakhs of crores to the eastern states, which will help them develop faster. But also during this interim period, the last 18 months, we were able to get the government coal companies to give extraordinary results. And it was the same people, after all, Coal India Limited, which added nearly 7% growth to its output last year and is currently at about 9.5% growth in production, is a company which has been running for years and years, decades. It usually grew at 1 or 2%, occasionally at 4%. And the norm was to grow at 2 or 3 or 4%. I remember another illustrious predecessor of mine from one of the ministries in the Lok Sabha taunting me that you are setting such big targets, 1 billion tons of coal by 2019-20. Do you even realize what you are saying? You'll fall flat on your face. But today when I look at the performance in barely 18 months of the 320,000 employees of Coal India Limited, who have been able to add such significant quantities and volumes of coal, 32 million tons last year. 32 million tons, by the way, in 2014-15, the added production was more than the addition that they did to production in 4 years from 2010 to 14. So 4 years incremental growth achieved in 1 year. And on a larger base this year, they want to do better. In fact, we were set for a double-digit growth. My problem is of surplus coal today. I'm not able to sell it as fast as they're producing it. And we are probably going to have to pull back a little bit in production because of problems of stocking coal. And today, in the entire country, not a single coal-based power plant, not one, has a shortage of coal. There's no critical coal plant. In fact, as an aggregate, I think the stock in the coal plant, in the thermal plants, the top 100 plants that we usually monitor, they have 25 days stock at the plant, at the power generating plant. And we would have about 40 days stock at the pit heads where the coal is mined. So the country today is moving from an era of shortages to an era of surpluses. And that is the systematic manner in which this government is trying to address each of the problems that we have faced. I mean, one can, as I said in the beginning, good management practices, when they are rewriting the growth story, rewriting the future of their organization or their country, as we are trying to do, the Hobson choice is between short-term gain or short-term pain to look for a longer-term gain. And therefore, instead of finding a shortcut to reallocate the mines to the earlier prior allottees in some form so that the system is easy and nothing is disrupted, we looked at this as an opportunity. Even though it was in the short run a lot of pain, even though for the 3 or 4 months, probably the entire coal and power ministry had to work 18 hours a day, but we were able to create a framework, an institutional framework, which will hold good not for a few years, not only for a few decades, but now for the entire future of this country, to ensure that our natural resources can never be given away for free, can never be given away in an arbitrary or illegal or non-transparent fashion. And therefore, in some sense, reflecting a microcosm of the hundreds of different programs that this government has initiated to try and bring about change, lasting change, change which outlives our lives or our government's life, but leaves behind for the next generation a much, much better future, a much more robust economy. And to my mind, I wouldn't be surprised if even this ensuing 2016-17, even though the global headwinds are quite disturbed, even though we are seeing pain all across the world and the effect of that is being felt in India as well, I would not be surprised, given the solid foundational work that has been done in the last nearly 2 years, given the fact that today, even government employees, even government servants, even public sector undertaking managers, corporate leaders, are seeing that this change from an era of uncertainty to a predictable and stable regime, this era of a change from dishonesty to a transparent and corruption-free government, these changes can actually herald probably a double-digit growth in the ensuing year itself, if not certainly in the years following. But this time, the growth that I envisage India is going to get into is going to be a growth which is reinvented growth. It's a growth under a new paradigm. It's a growth which is not just the traditional international or local factors playing up, but growth based on systematic, planned manner, so that we can get decades of good government, good governance, good growth, which can take us out of this continuous unfortunate web of poverty that we have seen for so many years, moving away from entitlements to empowerment, moving away from shortcuts to long, well thought out plans, in some sense like the Japanese do. I remember in a recent meeting I was sharing with Prime Minister when we were finalizing a visit that I was to go to Japan for. And I said, you know, the Japanese are very slow. It takes years to get anything done from them. And immediately Prime Minister Modi retorted, he said, but I like that. Aise hi hona chahiye. Kyunki jab Japanese kuch cheez plan karte hain, to wo jyada samay planning mein lagate hain, achhi tarike se, bahut vyavaharik tarike se, bahut sucharu dhang se, in a very, very planned and systematic manner. They put everything on paper, all plans, designs. The process is very pure, is very mature. Then implementation becomes very quick and very effective and efficient. And our idea is not to allow a situation where a railway project started in 1975 still remains incomplete in 2016, 41 years later, because of bad planning, because of inadequate proper funding, because of mismanagement and corruption, but rather focus on executing projects with precision, focus on well thought out schemes, focus on planning well, so that when we get down to execution, we can ensure that every rupee spent of the people of India is honestly spent, is spent well, and is truly effective in giving outcomes that will benefit the people at large and take India to the status of a Jagat Guru, a world leader, that we are in some sense, or in fact in every sense, destined to be. And I'm sure the young leaders of tomorrow who are a part of the IMA effort to take good management principles to the next level will all look up to these engagements as learning opportunities, as lessons which many a time may not come out of the case studies or the textbooks that you do in management college, but would probably come out from a verse of the Gita. And in some sense, very often it is said, history teaches us lessons, history teaches us a lot, and we can actually go back into history and learn what to do, how and what not to do, and how not to do. So in some, I was remembering the verse of the Gita which talked about management, and I'd had an opportunity to talk about management from the verses of the Gita recently at the Chinmay Mission in Pune. And I remember the verse which spoke about the role model as a leader. No matter what position a person may have, no matter whether he's a supervisor, whether he's a manager, or he's a big leader like Deepak Parekh ji or Professor Dr. Mashalkar, each one of us in our own spheres becomes a role model for somebody else. And we create an impact on the other due to our value systems, due to our character, due to our vision. And therefore, it is incumbent on each one of us managers assembled here to give the people in our team, to give the people with us, to give our colleagues, our employees, our partners, all stakeholders who work with us, true leadership, honest leadership, visionary leadership, a leadership full of character. And to my mind, if each one of us takes this as our duty not only to the organizations we work for, but our duty to the people of India, to this wonderful nation that we are all proud to be born in, then I have no doubt in my mind that we are destined for a great future. This country and all of us, citizens of this country, are destined to leave behind a nation which the world will look up to, a nation that we can all be proud of, a nation which provides equal opportunity for all, a nation which cares and looks after its citizens from birth until death, a nation which is with a heart of gold, and every person in this nation contributes to our efforts to nation building. My best wishes to the Indore Management Association and all of you illustrious business leaders, management leaders from Indore and other parts of Central India. I wish each one of you great success in your work, and I'm sure you will all hold the management flag high and make this country proud of you as managers. Thank you very much.